Hi everyone and welcome back. To get my CNC mill operating quickly, the mechanics receive more attention than the electronics. I've been slowly reorganizing the wiring to make testing new hardware and to prepare for moving electronics to an enclosure. To make moving components easier, I've mounted functional units to plates that are then mounted to a den rail. Movement is restricted along and between den rails, but removing functional units intact may be preferred to direct attachment to an enclosure subplate. To attach plates, den rail adapters are available. Particularly nice spring-loaded adapters are available from Phoenix Contact. For this heatsink project, we'll use less expensive stamp clips from Automation Direct. Grouping the stepper motor drives together on one plate makes sense. The drives will be wired similarly, and they may need to be removed for servicing. The aluminum plate serves as a heatsink and helps to ground the drives. While the clips grip the grounded den rail tenaciously, two tapped holes on the side of the plate serve as a secure grounding point if needed. Grounding improves safety and helps to reduce electrical noise in the neighboring electronics. The Leadshine ES-D508 drives have a built-in heatsink, which is also used for mounting. In the shown setup, the drives are mounted to wood, which also acts as an insulator. Without a supplemental heatsink, after running the mill warm-up exercise for 30 minutes, the drives are roughly 114 degrees Fahrenheit or 44 degrees Fahrenheit over room temperature. While 114 degrees Fahrenheit is below the 158 degrees Fahrenheit specified maximum, our heatsink will help the drive to run cooler. More contact area between the heatsink and the drive will improve heat transfer. Stock extruded aluminum has a small bow that must be faced flat. Besides improving heat transfer, a flatter surface will reduce warping of mating surfaces. The facing operation on the mill leaves a seemingly flat surface. However, with some dichem applied and a few lapping passes, the high spots are quickly revealed. The high spots are where the part was squeezed by the vise. The low spots are less supported areas that must have slightly flexed toward the cutting tool. Lapping is a process requiring patience. Progress quickly reduces as the area of the high spots increases. A lot of time is required to lap a surface this large by hand, and a respirator provides protection from the fine dust. In this setup, all the mounting holes for the drives are drilled and the holes for the den adapter clips are drilled and countersunk. Due to the part's size, it was supported on, not between, the 4-inch vise jaws for the facing operation, preventing the drilling operations during the facing setup. Completing the drilling and tapping operations before lapping would have been better. However, after the slotting operations, the heat sink would not be comfortable to hold by hand for lapping. All the mounting holes are tapped and deburred at the drill press. Now shown are the tapped holes on one side for the optional grounding straps. The spacing of the grounding holes allow ring terminals to lay flat. For this part, I tried at least three different milling strategies. The first strategy was 2D pocketing. The strategy was slow because the length of cut was so shallow. The strategy was also prone to breaking tools. The second strategy was 2D adaptive clearing. The length of cut was 1/2 the depth of the slot. This strategy was faster than the pocketing strategy, and no additional tools were broken. Given how well the 2D adaptive clearing strategy worked, the length of cut was increased to the full slot depth. The change worked great, and the machining rate doubled. No tools were broken. The third strategy is a 2D pocketing operation with a ramp entry. This strategy was used in contained slots where I was not able to get adaptive clearing to work. I tried to use a helix entry with 2D adaptive clearing, but never got it right. Pocketing worked, but I would like to learn a faster method. The slots took hours to mill, and much of the milling was done unattended. The sacrificial MDF board swelled as coolant was absorbed. Much of the swelling occurred near the end of the machining, starting slowly but progressing rapidly. Finding the part this warped was pretty sickening, but thankfully the part returned to shape once released. Checking the part at the lapping station, the only high spot was created during the very last slotting operation that cut all but 20 thou from the opposite side. Needless to say, I was lucky. To improve heat transfer between the drives and the heatsink, heat transfer compound is used. Electrical conductivity between the drives and the heatsink for grounding is desired for safety and to reduce electrical noise. Arctic Silver 5 heat transfer compound was selected because reviews indicated it's electrically conductive. Well, it's not at all conductive. Regardless, the oxide layer created by anodizing is also electrically insulating. The measured resistance between the heatsink and any drive is low, and the electrical path is likely through the mounting holes biting into the drive. To ensure better connection, one could consider serrated washers. To place a load on the drives and test that the heatsink helps, we'll run a loop of G-code that simultaneously exercises all three axes at roughly 120 inches per minute for at least 30 minutes. To measure temperature, we'll use a FLIR E5 infrared camera. The high infrared reflectivity of the heatsink surface requires some treatment. A couple pieces of thin tape works well. The surface temperature when the drives were attached to a wood surface was 114 degrees Fahrenheit. Mounted to a heatsink, the drive surface temperature drops to 97 degrees Fahrenheit. And the heatsink is at 95 degrees Fahrenheit. Granted, the drive orientation also changed in a way that will help with convective heat flow. The infrared camera is an amazing tool, especially for surveying large areas. For greater accuracy, direct measurements are preferred if possible. We'll use an X-Tech EA15 temperature data logger to simultaneously monitor temperatures of the heatsink and drives during our tests. The K-type thermocouplers are sandwiched between the measured surface and some tape. The upper red line in the graph is the temperature of the drive, and the lower blue line is the temperature of the heatsink. The Leadshine drives have configurable hold and run current settings. If I remember correctly, the default hold current is 1/2 that of the run current. The heatsink temperature graph contains more noise than the drive temperature graph, likely because of electrical noise encountering less resistance from the heatsink than from the anodized drive surface. While the mill exercise program is running, there is a slow periodic signal that does not correlate with anything obvious, including HVAC. A couple of 1/8 inch end mills were broke during this project while 2D pocketing. After switching to 2D adaptive clearing, no additional tools broke and machining rate increased. In the future, when making a part with a long, narrow slot, I'll try removing the bulk of the material by pre-drilling. In this example, pre-drilling efficiently removed 70% of the material before milling. A slotting saw was not practical in a vertical mill because of the length of the arbor that would be necessary. At first glance, this seems like a simple project, but even a simple project provides chances to learn. The final heatsink meets the original goals of providing a removable plate holding all the stepper motor drives and helping to reduce the operating temperature of the drives. I hope that you found this video useful. Please send any comments or suggestions you may have. And finally, I hope you'll be back for the next video.